Let's ride. Greetings, world. Greeting North America, South America, Central America, Motherland, Africa, the Far East, everybody. Greetings to all my peoples here in South Florida, all through Central Florida, all through North Florida. I'm talking Tallahassee, Jacksonville, Gainesville, Fort Walton Beach, Hermosa Springs, Ocala, Orlando, St. Petersburg, Tampa, New Smyrna Beach, all the way down to Immokalee, Brooksville, Naples, Port Charlotte, you name it. Particularly the Tri-County area, West Palm Beach, Fort Lauderdale, Miramar, Pembroke Pines, and of course, very hometown, AKA the Terror Dome, the Miami. This is Mr. O here, the Black Knight, the original OG, the triple OG himself, the true Dark Knight. And you know, normally, y'all know me for coming at y'all today. First thing, you know, happy Veterans Day to all the real veterans who stood up and fight for the civil liberties and the freedoms for everybody to do what they need to do in America to get justice, the fight against injustice. So happy Veterans Day to them. Now, normally y'all know me for coming on here and doing my show, WTF, which is White Thugs Friday, but I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna take a break from that for a while because you know everybody's still all in a tailspin about the presidential election, and everybody's been asking me via where it's been Twitter, where it's been YouTube, private messenger, and even on the streets about, you know, if I'm gonna speak about President-elect Donald John Trump. And I said, I'll go ahead and get around to it. But the more I thought about it, and I had to go into deep meditation for a minute, I said, let me go ahead and get my, because the chaos that's going on is just a little bit much. So, you know, so on that, expect me to do something on that next week. But I'm not here to talk about that here, though. So my apologies to my subscribers who wanted to talk about another White Thug Friday and stuff like that. If you want to listen to previous episodes, you could go to my Spreaker channel on Spreaker.com or download the app Spreaker, and you could download those episodes for yourself. Just look for Mr. O. That's capital M R period capital O, and they're right there. What I do want to do is go ahead and I want to pay homage, because this is a lot more closer to me here, home here in Miami, Florida. First thing, you know, pay homage and respect to an individual who I basically had the utmost respect for, and I was even in her presence during the time when I attended the Martin Luther King parades back in the 80s. Now, for those of y'all who about in the late 60s, early 70s, y'all know who I'm talking about. And of course I'm talking about with Janet Reno, you know, former Miami-Dade state attorney, former U.S. Attorney General during the Clinton administration, and she also made history too as being the first female attorney general. So that carried a lot of weight. As y'all know, for those who don't know, who's been living up under a rock for the past several days, that y'all know Janet Reno had passed away at the age of 78. And she's well known, well famous. My apologies for that. You know, other notables for that. Well, as a prosecutor, she was she was very blunt, very direct. Now, I'm going to tell you like this. Now, those for y'all who not from Miami and they know what I'm talking about, a lot of deadbeat dads would know Janet Reno very well. That's in my age bracket. On both male and female side. Because she didn't play the radio when it came down to that. And on top of that, like, that also kind of led to the way of what you got running rampant through our communities, your typical hood rats and, you know, baby mammies and stuff like that. But let me just get right down to it. I also fault these wannabe thugs too, because you know they would have been handling their business like they did when they want to lay down with these gals and procreate. Then you wouldn't have it and took care of they ward. They wouldn't have that problem. But Janet Reno, when she got appointed by Bill Clinton as being the first U.S. female attorney general. And she did a damn good job. I don't give a damn what nobody say when she was there, just like she did here. She was also at a center of a relentless series of political storms, two preferably, the one of the raid of the Branch Davidian compound in Waco, Texas. She took a lot of heat for that. And then something that really like kind of calmed everybody here, but you know, some of the Cuban immigrants here and all that, never forget this. From what tabloids say, to the seizure of 5-year-old Cuban immigrant Ilian Gonzalez. Let me touch on that for a second. First thing first, what Janet Reno did at that time, that was the right thing. At that time, we had a piece of filth that was Miami-Dade County Mayor, a spineless worm by the name of Alex Pinellas. He's teaching a class now. He's teaching classes now at St. Thomas University. He's a piece of shit, you know. He talked all that noise when, you know, they didn't want to return that boy back to his father over in Cuba. Because, you know, they found him on the shores here, because you know his mother died on the way here, and I guess the uncle and aunt, preferably that stupid girl, was just using their poor boy as a financial comeuppance, put it that way. Now myself, as several other people in the Dade and Broward in the tri-state area, both black, white, and Cuban, all have said the same thing. That boy belongs with his daddy. Plain and simple. All this stuff at that time, you know, when Janet Reno came down here the first time to try to go ahead and, you know, and claim the boy with INS and all this stuff like that, Alice Pinellas was talking major shit about this and that and all of that thing about Janet Reno. But then when Janet Reno showed up, he sort of like flipped the script. Even the reporter even asked him, all those things that you said about Attorney General at that time, Janet Reno, would you say those same things to her now, just like what you told us? I'm saying, you know what Pinellas did, being the bitch that he was, that he is? He turned around and tucked his legs between his tail between his legs like the hyena that he, like the cowardly hyena that he is. And they figured, see, that community figured that they want something because they thought they turned away Janet Reno, Bill Clinton, and all this stuff like that. But this is one reason why I say you don't play with that lady. April Fool's Day, in the middle of the night, they came up in there, grabbed the boy, and took him right back to his father. Yeah, hours after, a few days after his father came over from Cuba and won his boy back. Even when I watched it, my heart was like sank. I say, man, that's sad. That boy belonged with his father. But more importantly, I was most sad for Ileon Gonzalez at that time because he wasn't happy there. You know, some people was just using him, Bill Ryan, just to try to get money. That's all that was. It was a money thing. And what Janet Reno did was the right thing. Shoot, because you know what? Everybody here was sick and tired of hearing about it. Now at that time, the Cuban community thought, oh, they're going to shut down Miami, blah, blah, blah. They're going to do this, they're going to do that. Oh, we ain't gonna open up no businesses, none of the anything like that. All that stuff they were talking. But guess what? That day came, and you still didn't stop nothing going on here. I think this is the first time I think a few people actually got to work on time. To be honest with you. Which proved my point even more. Yes, Miami is a multicultural faceted city. Don't get me wrong. You got a lot of different cultures overlapping one another. Because I can tell you some story. I mean, I've been through the 90s. Anybody should know should be me. And a lot of other people within my age bracket. The point of the matter is, she the one who controlled the whole thing from the get-go. She's the top cop. It doesn't matter what former mayor Alex Pina says or what anybody else says. And then on top of that, on an economic tip, here in Miami, an economical tip, I get tired of people getting out here saying Cubans run Miami. Nah, man. When that day came, they showed y'all who run this. They showed you. Anybody with a lick of sense would know that the Jews run this thing. They call the shots. Because see, that junk that they pulled there, yeah, they pissed off a lot of them old 50 something year old white boys up there in Washington during that time with the Clinton administration. You know, aka the Clinton cartel. So what Janet Reno did, she did the right thing, and she let people know that she was in control the whole time. It's like fishing. We gonna give you a little leverage on the line. We're gonna lax that line a bit, but that hook's still gonna be in that grouper. And in the end, she ended up landing that fish. And here's something else I also saw the night too. You know, I heard it was little anti Reno rallies and all this other stuff like that, but you had other rallies that countered that. And this is something I'm gonna tell you right now. Anybody that's from Miami, y'all could come in on the chat room right now and tell me if I'm lying when I'm about to say that this is the first time that you seen the U.S. flag and the Confederate flag flying side by side together. Black, white, and Hispanic. Tell me if I'm lying. Go ahead, I'll wait. But to me, the most controversial, because we all got sick and tired of hearing about it, and And on top of that, a lot of my associates, a lot of my constituents, and a few coworkers, and stuff like that, we all said, don't matter what your ethnicity or racial background was, we all said it. That boy belonged with his father. Okay? But anyway, though, let me just get to his presence right here. Janet Reno, she died from complications of Parkinson's disease, same one that took our brother, Muhammad Ali. You know, so she spent her final days here in Miami, surrounded by family and friends. So, you know, so like, I mean, I never had an issue with the lady. You know what I'm saying? She did the right thing when she was here in Miami. She did the right thing when she was there in Washington. You know, I don't think any black person had a problem with Janet Reno. And I'm gonna tell you something else. This is something that you're gonna find real funny. I'm gonna tell you one of the realest things she did. There was a club that I used to frequent a lot back in the day. Which was Club Rolex. Everybody know what Club Rolex is. Let's just keep it real, you know. And I was there. And it just so happened, like, at that time, I knew who she was. I never seen her until that time. I seen her come walking in there. She walked right into the DJ booth, asked the DJ for the mic. Because it was a big night that night, you know. Money was flowing around, blah, 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 like this. She said on the mic, and I didn't forget this. It's so funny. But it's true. She came in there, sat on the mic. She said, just stop the music. What I'm holding in my hand here is a list of all the individuals here that were 2-3 months backed up in child support payments and failed to address them. If your name is on this list that I got, and it was a 3-page list, by the way, on this list, get up, walk out to that front door, and turn yourself in. Oh, and by the way, don't bother trying to jump in your car or try to run or try to book for it, because I got Miami Metro-Dade sheriff's deputies surrounding the whole place. And I'm like, whoa. Boy, look at here. I seen a couple of guys tried to break camp. Boy, them police dogs got on them so quick. I'm like, shoot, by the time I left, we seen the wagon full of dudes up in there. And these were the ones up here with buying bottles left and right, had stacks of money, this and that, giving it to the dancers, blah, blah, blah. Hey, y'all know what, this is Club Rolex. Y'all don't act like y'all don't know what goes on in the strip club. I seen that, and I say, ooh, boy, look at here. You know. But no doubt that she was one of the Clinton administration's most recognizable and polarizing figures. You know, because she was also around at that time in the center of Whitewater, Filegate, the bungling at the FBI laboratory, Monica Lewinsky, the alleged Chinese nuclear spy, Christopher campaign financing in the 96 Clinton re-election campaign. But she also did a great thing too during her tenure. Justice Department, she prosecuted the 95 Oklahoma City bombing, you know, that led to the arrest of Timothy McVeigh. She captured the Unabomber, Theodore Kaczynski, the same year. And then she investigated the 1993 terrorist attack on New York's World Trade Center. People tend to forget about that. At the same time, the Department of Justice also filed a lawsuit against Microsoft. And also keep in mind, Jan Arena was also a strong advocate for protecting abortion clinics from violence at that time. Because, like, the thing with her was like this. Jan Arena, she began her career in Miami in the mid-1960s. And I was born in 68, so that's how I knew about her during my time growing up. And I had her first encounter with the glass ceiling, you know, getting passed over for a job at a law firm because she was a woman. She later made partner. 1972, she lost the race for a Miami area legislative seat, but learned the importance of sticking to her principles from her mentor, John Orr, who was a former state lawmaker. Her thing was like this, she said, "Don't equivocate, don't pussyfoot, don't talk out of both sides of your mouth, and you'll wake up the next morning feeling good about yourself." That's what he told Jan Arena, and that became one of her favorite sayings. And you know what? That's how I am. I don't have a problem with that. But when she lost that election, that's when she was hired by the Dade State's Attorney's Office, where she established herself as an organized and competent lawyer. When Richard Gernstein, back in 78, he stepped down, Jan Arena was the one. I mean, she did some all right things. I mean, she built programs to help reform drug dealers, combat domestic violence. And like I said, another program, Strong Arm Deadbeat Dads into Paying Child Support. It was even a rap song named after her. It included the line, and I quote, "All the money you get, all the checks you make, Jan Arena will make sure and take." I forgot about that. I forgot which one did. I think it might have been a Two Live Crew song. I don't know. You know, but also through bad times too. In 1980, a lot of people don't forget, she weathered the ride after all-white jury acquitted 5 police officers during the McDuffie riots, who was Arthur McDuffie, a black insurance salesman. You know, 18 people were killed in that riding. You know, yeah, a lot of us accused her of being racist and demanding her resignation. She refused. But the hug to resign was to give in to anarchy. But I'm gonna tell you something. That lady, she had our respect after that, because she won our support because she attended a lot of community meetings in the black community, church services and parades. And I told you, I came across her at a Martin Luther King parade when it used to be held right there on 62nd Street before they moved into that bullshit 54th Street up there. So, but her last foray here was for race for governor. During her time in the Justice Department, guess who also worked under her? Former Attorney General Eric Holder. But, you know, my thing to Jan Arena, she will be missed. I mean, the black community, she always gonna have our utmost respect, because I'm saying she one of the few white people that did something and try to make a difference for us when some of us didn't want to do it for ourselves. So, with my regards in this, and I'm going to just cut this podcast short. Rise in Power, Janet Reno, she always going to be a part of South Florida, period. And with that said, I'm going to be coming back to y'all Monday. Look out for the Monday O report. So, you know what I'm saying? I'm still doing some more things on that because I want to get this whole thing about like how Commander-in-Chief Orange Oompa Loompa got to the presidency. He's not Commander-in-Chief yet. Commander-in-Chief-elect Orange Oompa Loompa got in there. And it's going to be a lot of things going to be talked about, explained in the, from the coonery and the buffoonery on both sides to the senseless protests, to everything. So with that said, I'm your host of The Amazing Show, the one and only, the Triple OG himself, the Black Knight himself, Mr. O, and I'm signing out. Peace out. Hey, this is Mr. O here, man. Also, if y'all really want, if you want to, you can go to Spreaker.com on your PC or on your PC or tablet if you like. Or if you got Android, you go to the Play Store and download the app Spreaker, the yellow star that says Spreaker Podcast Radio. Or if you got iOS, it's also there in the App Store as well. You can also go there and type in hashtag The Amazing Show. And you can download any of my episodes if you want to go ahead and really re-listen to them. So you know, check that out on top of that. Also, shout out to a lot of black-owned businesses. Shout out to AU Beauty. That happens to be on 5725 Northwest 7th Avenue in Miami. Hair, nail shop and all that, hair salon, nail salon, stuff like that. So check it out. With that, I'm out.